I have a sister who's a civil engineer in northern part of England. Her longest day to fast is about 19 and a half hours. And her shortest day is only about 8 hours. The next pillar of Islam is charity. It's called zakat. How many of you know tithing? What's tithing? Tithing. That means you guys are not giving any charity to your churches. That's what it shows like. I'm saddened by it. So, in Islam, it is compulsory for every Muslim to take 1/40th part of his annual savings and holdings and find and seek out the poor and the needy and give it to them, which comes to 2.5%. There is no enforcement rule. There is no hierarchy in Islam. There is no pope. There is no rabbi. I am the pope in my house. I am the rabbi in my house. I am the ordained minister in my house. That's in everybody's. And it's between God and me, or between God and my household. Whether I give that zakat, that charity or not, I'll be answerable on the day of judgment. Whether I fast or not, I'll be answerable to God on that day. So this charity, again, is compulsory. There is another charity which is called sadaqah. So when you meet with a rabbi, he tells you what sadaqah is. That is compulsory in the Jewish faith. Sadaqah is a voluntary charity that can be done 24/7 in any form, cash, kind, pro bono work, volunteer work to help fellow mankind. Because the scripture says, to whom is given much, to whom is given much, those churchgoers can say that. Much is expected. So if you have wealth, it's not for you to go and buy a Lamborghini or Bentley or something else. Make sure that the poor are fed. Make sure that the poor have housing. Make sure the have-nots are taken care of. The difference between human beings and all others is very simple. The animal world, you have survival of the fittest. Amongst human beings, it is the duty of the fittest to make sure there is the survival of the weakest. Let me repeat. It is the duty of the fittest amongst human beings to make sure there is the survival of the weakest. So if you want to be an animal, that's your choice. That's okay. But according to scriptures, it says, if you have wealth, give it, distribute it, make sure nobody is hungry, nobody is homeless. You don't do it, you ignore it, you'll be answerable to the day of judgment. You have knowledge, dispense it. It's not for you to keep it. Dispense it. If you have a skill, give it. Your profession is not just for you to make money. It is to help others. If you're a doctor, it's to heal the people. Your primary goal should not be money. Why do the societies and superpowers fall? Because they become selfish, greedy, opulent, and they think, I got mine, you get yours. That is not the definition of a human being. That's the definition of an animal. So Islam emphasizes on that continuously, constantly. And when do you reflect on these kind of values, instead of reading Harry Potter or things like that, they're not useful to you in your life. It is important to know what a baton can do instead of just being a magic wand. So knowledge, a useful knowledge, is what one must seek. These are the kind of values that we are supposed to contemplate during the month of fasting. In the month of fasting, if I were to use any cuss word, my fast is broken. If I become angry with my wife or my children, My fast is broken. My fast is nullified.
Have you ever broken your fast?
Yes. Yes, I have. One time somebody cut me off on the road and I called out some expletive. And next thing I had to do was repent and I had to make it up, that fat broken fast. And yes, one time I even yelled at my daughter, hard enough that she was crying. I'm an ex-naval guy, I'm an ex-navy officer. I do not allow people to lie to me. Tell me the truth. I do the same thing. Did that as a commander, as anything else. I'm president of the Islamic Study of Baltimore. I have people from 80 different countries represented there. From 80 different countries. There are over 30,000 Muslims in the greater Baltimore area. Very diversified. And I would like to invite all of you, anytime you like, to visit the Islamic Study of Baltimore. And you see it for yourself, not from what I'm saying. See it for yourself. The diversity that you will see, and the different dress code you will see, and just hear people speaking different languages. That is our strength in our country. We are a diverse people. We are the only country in human history that has people from every part of the world, every different ethnic group, every different religious group. We are blessed. We are blessed that all of us being different from each other, from the looks, from backgrounds, from cultures, that we are all under one umbrella. Excuse me. This diversity has to be enriched, not by pushing each other away. The population of Anne Arundel County that I started off with was English, German, then it became Irish, when many of them came here as indentured servants, and then they were replaced by African Americans as slaves, and the majority population became that of African Americans. Now, since last 16 years, from the census of 2000 to now, the percentage of Asians and Hispanics has increased from 12% to almost 25%, has doubled in the last 16. And I'll just maybe give you one little story. My grandfather was a dean of a university, and this is going back to 1950s.
Thank you.
And I was on a goodwill mission, and I was traveling from Pakistan's main port called Karachi to Kenya, to Mozambique, to South Africa, to South America and Brazil, and then to Baltimore, my first visit in 1967. I could not get off the ship because there were riots going on. The city was burning. There was a newspaper. So I somehow was able to get the newspaper. When I went back after a year of tour, my grandfather wanted to know if I visited America and what it was. I said, I couldn't go, I couldn't see it because there were riots between blacks and whites. He became very stern. And he's a dean of a university, not an uneducated, illiterate person. And he said, what did you say? I said, Grandpa, there were riots between the blacks and the whites. He said, son, stop telling me stories. What do you know of blacks and whites? What are they? They're not human beings? I tell you, my butt was saved because I had to prove to him, thank God for the newspaper that I picked up. I showed him the newspaper. I said, here it is. It saved that maximum. This is beyond comprehension that we were one of the only countries in the world who differentiated or discriminated fellow human being who just happens to have a different skin color. So what's the skin color got to do with it? And he banished everyone in the family never to visit America. He said, people who do not respect other people don't deserve to be recognized as people. He said, that's being an animal. So we cannot live in a cocoon and think everybody likes it, whatever we do. Everybody has pock marks on their faces. No country is pure. It's what we make it. Country is what we make it. That requires respect for each other. And again, I want to say, your school, you guys are lucky because they give you this kind of exposure by bringing people like me. I'm not a scholar, I'm not a politician, I'm not a religious person. I try my best. I'm also a commissioner on the Human Relations Commission. And what kind of cases I see? I see discrimination cases. Employment, housing, gender, all kinds of discrimination cases I see. Do you know that every 16 seconds, a woman in our country gets either raped, sexually assaulted, or murdered? That doesn't happen in Muslim countries. Because you are toast as a man. You try to raise your hand on a woman, the whole clan is going to come after you. You kill one innocent, the whole tribe is going to come after you for revenge. That's not Islamic. That's cultural. Yes, there is some domestic abuse. Yes, there are rapes. They're not perfect. But not with that kind of number. The respect for each other is the primary source of peace. If there is no justice, there cannot be peace. That's a prerequisite. You can just look at your own family. If mom or dad favors one sibling over the other, you say, that's not fair. You favor that. You feel violated. You feel there is no justice. You will rebel. So to do justice is the most primary responsibility of anyone who is in charge, who is head of a household, who is head of an institution, who is head of a community, who is head of a town, who is head of a country. Justice to keep peace and harmony amongst people. If there is equal justice, I can assure you there will be nobody hungry in place. There'd be nobody who'd be homeless.
Forgive me for interrupting, but I know several students have questions to ask as well. So I have about 20 minutes left or so. I was wondering if you could.
Good. So I'll wrap it up.
Yes.
So in summary, Muslims believe in the oneness of God. They believe in the scriptures, in the prophets, all the prophets. As a matter of fact, I wrote down the English names as opposed to the Arabic names, but that's always difficult for me to remember. And some of these names, what I'll do is just for your ears, I'll say them in Arabic, what is in the Quran, and then in English. We know Adam, peace be upon him, Idris, which is Enoch, E-N-O-C-H, Noah, Ibrahim, which is Abraham, Ismail, which is Ishmael, Ishaq, which is Isaac, Lut, which is Lot, Yaqub, which is Jacob, Yusuf, which is Joseph, Ayub, which is Job, Musa, which is Moses, Harun, which is Aaron, Dhul-Khafil, which is Isaiah, Zechariah, which is Zechariah, Yahya, which is John the Baptist, Isa, which is Jesus, and Muhammad, peace be upon all of them. All of these prophets, I just brought them so that you could know that Muslims believe in all of those prophets and many others. And then we believe that everyone, God creates anything, He will sustain it. Not GE or Procter Gamble is going to give me food or my livelihood. Everything comes from God. If I'm standing here today, it's not a coincidence that on this day, somebody by the name of Muhammad Jameel would be standing here and talking about Islam. Nobody knew that. I didn't know that. So everything is preordained. All we have to do is do our best. And then God finds the ways, God creates the ways and the means to sustain you, to inform you. You have a choice. You have a free will.